Now, if you have just joined us, you're watching Video Showcase. The Caribbean stars will be celebrating their first anniversary on Saturday, the 25th of April. And as part of that celebration, they're presenting a show called Sparkling Stars and Rainbows at the Cecil Cyrus Squash Complex. Starting time, 7:30 p.m., admission only $10. Proceeds are in aid of Student Scholarship Fund. And then on Sunday the 26th, Jogan will be launching their presentation for 1998. They're inviting you to be there. Now up next, Dr. Adrian Fraser with our Black History segment.
This evening we feature King JAJA, with whose name many might be familiar, but are perhaps not sure who he was or how he came to be associated with this country. On June 9, 1888, the British ship, the HMS Icarus, sailed into the Kingston Harbor. It was 11 in the morning and the day was a Saturday. On board were King JAJA of Opobo in what is now Nigeria, his son Sunday, and an attendant named Don. JAJA was the victim of British conspiracy, was tried in Accra, Ghana, on trumped-up charges, and sent into exile. The real issue was that he stood between the British and their control of the lucrative palm oil trade. His original destination seemed to have been Grenada, but there was some problem with the accommodation there. JAJA and his party were not allowed to land on that day. Saturday was the customary day when the peasants brought their produce to the market. Governor Walter Hutchinson was not prepared to take any chances. He explained, and I quote, "St. Vincent possesses an unenviable notoriety for disturbances. In 1862, during the administration of Sir Alexander Musgrave, there were serious riots. In 1885, Sir William Robinson was stoned on the wharf, and the house in which he lived in the town was surrounded by a howling mob. And I am informed that there have been several occasions on which people have come into collision with the forces of order." End of quote. That was the governor's explanation for not allowing JAJA to land on the Saturday. But as it turned out, despite the secrecy surrounding the arrangements, a large crowd gathered on the Sunday morning. Also present were members of the council. A carriage was arranged to take the African gentleman to the area of the fort where he had been provided with a house. A loud cheer from a curious Vincentian crowd greeted him. A newspaper of the day, the Sentinel, noted that he wore a Panama straw hat and was attired in a suit resembling an admiral's uniform. A meeting of the Legislative and Executive Council had been convened on the Saturday to draft ordinances for his detention and that of his party, which was later increased with the arrival of his wife Patience and four attendants. An issue of protocol surfaced very early, for the administrator was unsure about the manner in which he was to deal with his guest, the exiled king. He therefore awaited instructions regarding the official attitude to be adopted toward him. JAJA's house at the fort was one formerly occupied by the inspector of police. He found the location too breezy and cool and had to be moved elsewhere, to a house believed to be the one now occupied by the British American Insurance Company and the National Lottery. JAJA never reconciled himself to life in exile. He complained constantly about the lack of an appetite and his inability to digest food. He reminded the authorities that he was an old man, not expected to live much longer. He did not want to spend the remainder of his life in exile, but rather to return to die in the land of his birth. JAJA's presence had aroused the curiosity of Vincentians, no doubt because of the novelty of having an African prince in their midst. He attended numerous social functions where he was introduced to leading members of the society. Generally, however, JAJA was unhappy, reminiscing always about the treachery to which he was exposed and writing regularly to the British authorities in an effort to end his exile. We We'll break this feature on JAJA at this point, and we'll continue with it next week.
Children.